All right, before we start, I want to tell you a story. I was at the Edinburgh Festival performing for the Fringe, and there's this joke store, right? And they have all these like masks and this, you know, like real like modern looking ones, like good quality. I put on this old man mask, right? The customer walks around the aisle and goes, "Oh!" like that. And I went, "Oh, sorry about that." And I took the mask off. She went, "Ah!"
Now, Lucky Diamond, for those of you that haven't seen Lucky Diamond, is regarded as the world's most tattooed person.
My tattoos are just a part of who I am.
If there's anybody that represents the phrase, "Don't judge a book by its cover," well, I'd say I'd be it.
My name's Lucky Diamond Rich. I was born Gregory Paul McLaren. I'm the most tattooed person in the world, the Guinness World Record holder. I was in show business, you know, I was a street performer, and I'm a tattoo artist. I grew up in Brisbane. I sort of, the area that I was from was West End, East Brisbane, Coorparoo area. Because I never grew up with my father, I adopted my stepfather's maiden name. For probably about 10 years, I thought I was Gregory Goller. I didn't know that it wasn't my real father. I looked at the birth certificate, which was a New Zealand birth certificate. It said Gregory Paul McLaren. And then when I was 18, I changed my name to Richie Rich. I was in show business. I was a street performer. I wanted to have a catchy show name. I think I was about 27. I got involved in electronic music group called Primitive Ghost, and I was doing vocals on it, and there was a few Richie Riches in the music industry. So I changed my name to Lucky Rich. Lucky Rich sounded good to me, so I changed it to that. And then a really good friend of mine here in Sydney always used to call me, you're a diamond, mate, you're a rough diamond, you know? And I was like, oh. The idea of having a middle name was great, so I changed my name to Lucky Diamond Rich. You know, I never really felt like I belonged, you know, because at the beginning, you know, my mum, she would move from place to place. So I'd go from this school to that school and, you know, make friends there, and then I'd have to leave them, and, you know, so it was difficult. My mum was doing it pretty tough, you know, being a single mother and looking after two children, my stepbrother and myself. It was hard for her because, you know, she obviously had stuff going on for herself. There was a lot of alcoholism. There was a lot of drug addiction. You know, there was a lot of stuff that my mum's generation and my grandmother's generation inherited. I guess it was about late 90s. My auntie and some other relatives did a lot of family research. And it was amazing, you know, to find out that, you know, my family's indigenous. My grandmother's generation didn't really talk about it. It was sort of frowned upon. My mum really couldn't sort of talk about it. I guess there was a lot of shame, I think, about being indigenous. I just turned to art to escape.
I developed a knack to be able to make my mum laugh. Then it went on to making everyone laugh. That was what I was into. I was into making people happy.
Anything to do with art, performance, yeah, I took to it like a fish to water. That's all I've ever really done. And it's given me a pretty amazing life. I was part of a community circus group from when I was 8 years old till I was 14. Because I was really good at it, they asked me to join their adult group. Kept hearing whispers about the traditional circuses and stuff like that. I just decided that would be really good for me to join Australia's oldest traditional circus, which was Ashton Circus. It's a circus game with you and me. I'm up on the top. And then I became a solo street artist. So then I was able to have my own show, suitcase full of props, passport and a backpack, and I could travel the world performing, you know, doing what I love.
You go out there and you feel godlike.
When I started traveling, I was really good at it already, you know. So really, I guess all the things that happened when I was a child kind of led me to a place where I was able to fit into that kind of lifestyle. I was connected to, you know, minority groups, you know, like the circus community, the arts community, the street performing community, the tattoo community.
One layer I've had about 85%, that was the first layer. The second layer was 100%, entirely covering the whole 85. And then now it's white and colour tattoos over the top of the solid black. So
right,
that's another percentage on top of that.
My first tattoo, I think I was just a little bit amazed at the fact that you could choose something from the wall and someone could actually put that on your body and it would be there for the rest of your life. I was just amazed. I thought that was just the most amazing thing. There was this butcher up the road from where we used to live in West End, and he had like three fingers and he had like old like English tattoos on his arm. And I remember getting the bubble gum, and you get these like little tattoo like stick-ons, and so I'd like lick it, stick it on, but I wouldn't just like put one on. I'd learned that you could like put multiple the same ones on. You know, I just remember thinking, you know, oh, you know, I want to be like that butcher guy.
I was 16. I was traveling with Ashton Circus. I went to King's Cross to the Red Light District in Sydney. It was a little juggling club. I was a juggler, and just a little skittle juggling club had on the side of my hip. Mm-hmm. Believe it or not, I got it there because I was worried about what my mother thought.
I just knew the more I invested in my show and who I was, the richer the whole thing would become. You know, it just felt like the right thing to do. So people would like pay me to do my show. They pay for my lifestyle. So that's what I did. And so I went all over the world and I collected tattoo art from some of the best artists in the world. And then I run out of room. And then I started covering certain stuff that I didn't want anymore. And then I came up with the idea of becoming the first person to ever cover themselves entirely 100% with black ink. People would say, oh, you can't get your hands done, or you can't get your neck done, or you can't get your face done, you can't get your head done. And I was just like, I was just so like not into being told that I couldn't do anything. Every tattoo had some sort of significance and importance to me. I got like a traditional Thai tattoo style done by a Thai monk in Singapore, and he tattooed two lucky symbols on either like side of my shoulder. I had two Borneo rosettes done, which went on both shoulders. You know, a lot of the groups that I've been connected with throughout my life have been real quite sort of fringe, on the fringe minority groups. If I think about my ancestors, you know, they were fringe minority group. I felt like throughout my life I was sort of connecting with different cultures through the tattoo. I was connecting, but I wasn't connecting to my culture. I think it was when I was living in Newtown that I'd found out. I think that was around the same time. Which is ironic because I was living in the Aboriginal mural. It was amazing, you know, to find out that I'm Indigenous. for me, a lot of the healing that I've been able to do with my family is to discover and connect with Aboriginal culture. I just think it's quite ironic that around the time that I found out about my Aboriginal Indigenous heritage, I had all this investment of culture from all over the world on my body through the art of tattoo, and then I decided to cover it all up entirely, you know, with black. For me, you know, I missed out on a lot of stuff that people consider quite normal, you know. I'm only just starting to connect with that stuff now. You know, I'm connected to all different communities at the moment. I've been a support worker in an Aboriginal rehab in St Kilda called Gallyamble. That was really amazing for me to be able to help. I'm definitely more connected than I ever have been. You know, like I spread myself out pretty thin for quite a while throughout my life. I actually feel like I belong, whereas before I didn't really feel like I did. Like, my identity is not wrapped up in being the most tattooed man in the world. And it's not wrapped up in being lucky diamond rich either, you know? Like, I work on a construction site at the moment where I'm a machine operator. I just get in a machine, I go to work on time, I get there early, I leave late, I do as I'm told, I get paid, I pay taxes, pay my bills. I've got my wife, I've got my two dogs, I got a great job. I don't really perform that much these days, and I do the odd tattoo on mates and various friends that want to get tattooed. You know, I live a pretty normal life these days. That's all I ever really wanted. Never thought it would actually be possible, but it's actually what's happened. I'm definitely powerless over other people and what they think or what they say, but I'm definitely not powerless over how I think and what I say. You know, I definitely don't focus too much on my external life. A lot of my focus goes into what's going on for me internally, and the more I do that, the better my external life kind of gets. If there's anybody that represents the phrase "don't judge a book by its cover," well, I'd say I'd be it. Oh, can I just say, I find it really funny that you say, let's talk about your adult life. I don't think I've ever been an adult.